and thank you so much for joining us. Today I'm going to be talking to one of our foster carers, Karen, about life as a foster carer. We're going to be live this morning. We're live right now. So if you've got a question or a comment, please do pop it in the chat and we'll try and answer those at the end. So let's welcome Karen.
Hi, Helen.
Hi, Karen. Thank you so much for joining us today. Now, Karen, you've been a foster carer for many years now, haven't you? So thinking back to when you first considered becoming a foster carer, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I started thinking about becoming a foster carer in about 2003. And it took a little bit of time. You know, you when you first start thinking about it, you're not sure. Did a little bit of research, came back, and I finally got approved in 2004. Maybe I didn't do as much research as I should have, but I think that's a mistake. That's a mistake we all make, isn't it?
So I was going to ask you that, like, what sort of research did you do, and, you know, what did you find helpful?
I went on to agency websites and had a look at those, and I went to one or two fostering, you know, these evenings where your potential carers can come and they just have a chat with you. I must admit, the one put me off a bit because all they talked about was allegations, which rather frightened me. But, yeah, you know, you get through that and you realise it's what you want to do. So you just go and do it.
Well, I suppose back in the early noughties, there maybe wasn't as much information on the internet, you know, as there is now, really, was there? Nowadays, a whole wealth of research that you can find out there, particularly with NFG, you know, or if you go onto YouTube, Facebook, you know, we've got loads of videos. So if people are looking now, there's quite a lot more, isn't there, for people to find?
I have to agree with you. In fact, the way I found out was on the back of a bus.
That's what they were doing back in the day.
Oh dear, but it was.
Can you remember, Karen, thinking back to, you know, 2003, 2004, how were your family and friends and your support network involved in your decision-making process?
Well, everybody was keen. Everybody said, oh, come on, do it. You're a really good mum. You know, kids gravitate towards me. I was always picking up waifs and strays in the community. You had, you know, if they were scared and they were needed a home to sleep in for a night, I was always doing that anyway. So it just seemed a natural step to just formalize it and look for children, you know, that I could help through a structured way rather than just I'm a safe house for a child. So, I mean, everybody knew what I was doing and everybody was really keen and said, go for it. You know, you'll do well in it. And yeah, I love it. I would never, ever consider any other career now.
So, thinking back to, you know, when you were in that sort of thinking process, you know, in the early noughts, like, you know, should I make it formal, you know, should I do it? Can you remember the moment that you were like, yes, I'm going to do it?
I think it was, there was a young lad who came and slept over and he said to me how safe he felt. And he just said to me, oh, you'd be a great mum for someone like myself. And it made me realise, you know, that, hang on, I really do need to put it more formally because, you know, I'd like to do it full time rather than just, you know, if there's a child out in the community that one of my children was friendly with, what, you know, maybe parents were having a bit of a disagreement and they just wanted a quiet space. So yes. I think that young lad coming that particular night was my, you know, he's talking sense. This is what I must do. Yeah. Up until then, I'd actually been fostering cats.
And you still have cats now?
I still have cats, but, you know, start small, start with kittens.
So that was your eureka moment. That's really lovely.
That was my eureka moment.
Yeah. And how did you find the assessment process then? Because obviously, you know, you were then making it formal, you were then making it official. You had to go through an assessment. What was that like?
I found that quite daunting. I mean, it is quite intrusive and there's just no two ways about it. We need to let all foster carers know it's not someone who just comes into your home, has one visit and it's all done and dusted. It takes about 6-8 months. There's lots of visits. They dig into everything. You know, and the hardest part for me was that they even wanted the views of my ex-husband, who, although I have an okay relationship with, it wasn't, you know, we weren't best of friends and I was rather nervous of that, but, you know, they reassured me and said it's important that they get the views from everybody that had been involved with me and my children in the past. So, you know, that's something that potential foster carers need to understand. You know, it's really important that everybody, you know, gets to be involved in your assessment.
Yeah, and it, as you say, it is very thorough, but obviously it's very thorough for a reason. And you say it took 6 to 8 months. It can be shorter than that now. It can be shorter than 6 to 8 months. But, you know, either way, it is very thorough. But you have support right the way through that process, don't you?
Yeah, I did. I mean, I had a lovely assessor. She was really super and helped me with everything. We discussed scenarios, situations, what could happen, how would I manage this, how would I manage that. I do know that nowadays assessments are quicker, but in those days it really felt like you were going through the mill. Came through it on the other side and loving it.
So after you were approved, Karen, how did you prepare for your first child to come and live with you? Can you remember that first child?
I remember it as clear as day, and it's not conventional. But I don't know if they'd allow it today. I was approved for one, and I had a little box room, and I made it all very pretty. I was, you know, you always have your plans. I'm going to have a little girl, and she's going to have the best bedroom. And I went through panel, got approved in panel, was my birth date. So I went to London to go and have lunch with friends. Got a phone call, you've got to come home now. There's two boys waiting for you. So all the best plans in the world. That's the one thing I will say about fostering. With the best plans and will in the world, just be aware that, you know, things change and needs change. So I had to rush home, and I had two little seven-year-old twin boys sitting at my doorstep in their pajamas, crying their eyes out. They were so scared that Santa wouldn't know where they'd moved to, because it was just before Christmas. And that's stayed with me forever, is that the importance of trying not to move children over Christmas. Yeah. Because there were these two little seven-year-olds, and they were looking under my tree. And, of course, obviously I hadn't had a chance to do any shopping for them or anything. And they were just so scared that Santa would forget them. So, yeah, a very, very strong impression. They're now 24. They stayed with me for 13 years.
And
I'm one of the stickability people. I don't easily move my children on. They did stay a little bit on staying put, which is a service for after being in care. And we often laugh and say, what was the first thing that you remember about me? And they said the dog, and that I gave them a bowl of ice cream at 7 o'clock at night. So it just shows you, there I was thinking about the Santa, but all they were remembering was this bowl of ice cream that they got when they arrived.
Yeah. So I think we can definitely say you expect the unexpected, don't you? As you say, you weren't expecting those two boys, but how, you know, it ended up being with you for so long and being such a big part of your life.
They were meant to be with me for 2 weeks. And that's what fostering is, you know, you're an emergency placement. It's just temporary, and then it just clicked and they stayed.
So, Karen, we've had a message here from Pam that says, God bless you, Karen, and all foster carers out there.
Thank you, Suzanne. That's lovely to hear. I love my job.
And how does it make you feel, really, the positive impact that you've had on so many children and young people?
I love it. I mean, I'm a fierce advocate for children, and I always believe foster carers are in a unique role where we can really fight for children and make sure that the children that we care for get a voice. So for me, the most important thing is making sure that children are safe, making sure that they get what they deserve, and just fighting their corner.
Yeah. And we've already heard some of your beautiful moments there, memories that you've had over the years. But are there any more that you can share, memorable moments from your years as a foster carer?
I love taking children on holidays to Spain or Greece or, you know, just a local haul. And most of the children have never had a holiday before. And I always make sure I take a photograph of their faces while they're on the plane as the engine. You know, when the engine just revs to pull off and you just see these children's faces, they just light up.
Yeah.
And then I've got the camera waiting, and people on the plane think I'm crazy, but And then we often, you know, then I put into their life story work, which is something that we do. We keep photographic memories of all the things we do with children. And I've got all my children with their photographs of their face when the plane first kicks off. It's such a magical moment to watch.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now, Karen, when we do these lives on Facebook and YouTube, we always get lots of practical questions and suggestions. And obviously, you've been doing this for so long. We'd love to pick your brains. So if you could just share some of your foster carer knowledge with us. So firstly, how do you welcome a child into your home? You touched on it a little bit earlier on, but what's the sort of standard thing that you do?
I always make sure there's a present on the bed when they arrive, and I wrap it so that when they come into their bedroom, there's a present, which just distracts them a little bit. When children come to you, the one thing that, I mean, we have the ideal, but then we have the reality. And the reality is normally they don't come with their own social worker. They come with a duty social worker. So the child's been removed from their home. They don't really know the worker, and they're coming into your home, which is a strange environment. So they really are frightened. The worker normally leaves within 30 minutes. So really the most important thing is about making them feel at home, feel welcome, and feel safe.
Yeah,
and that's all what it is. You know, I normally, thankfully, I've got pets, because normally pets is the first thing that children gravitate towards. They want to know where, you know, where's your dog, where's your cat? And that's the opener. And then we'll go up to their bedroom, and I always make sure there's a gift that, you know, I normally do a little bit of digging beforehand to find out what they like from the social worker.
Yeah.
So that it's appropriate and what they would be expecting. And then I also never unpack on the night. We leave that for another day.
Yeah.
And it might be that we'll just sit down and watch a movie together, or order a favorite takeaway or takeout, just something, anything to make them relax and not think about what's happening to feel calm.
Yeah, to make them feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. And we've talked about your cats and dogs. They're obviously very important. What's the one single person that you'd never be without?
I think my son. he's really been amazing. My son and I foster together. We're not your conventional mum and dad or husband and wife, but it works for us, you know, and he loves the role, so I couldn't do the job without him.
Yeah. And what's your favorite thing to do with the weekend, maybe with your son and any foster children that you have? What's your favorite activity?
Well, when it comes to the boys, we have my son will take the boys out, and normally the boys, it's a boys' day out, which they love, and that's where boys go and do boy things. They're going to have their hair cut, they're going to have lunch or a movie, and they just will go and sit and watch planes taking off at the airport. And then for me, I've also got a little girl, and with her, my weekends are run by her, and it's shopping, 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 shopping. Luckily, I'm at the age I am, so I don't need much, because she makes sure she spends it all on her. But yeah, no, we do have a good time, and you know, it's all about activities, about getting out, it's about allowing children just to have fun, you know, have good memories while they're with you.
Yeah. And we talked about your ice cream earlier on, obviously. But are there any other sort of items of food that you always make sure you've got in the cupboard or the freezer when new children come to stay with you?
Well, I have a policy of a full fridge, because when you get children that come into care, often they come from homes where there's no food or the fridges are empty. So there's a lot of anxieties around food with children that come into you. So what happens is, you know, I've had children that just open my fridge door, look, and just stand, and then close it, and then go upstairs, then come back down and open the fridge again. It's about reassuring them that they won't go hungry when they're at my home, you know, and I've stuck to that policy, always having a full fridge. Yeah. I don't mind if they eat the food. I don't mind if, you know, I understand why they, you know, they might be sort of snacking. It's a difficult time for them to adjust from a home life where most of them have not been able to have just open a fridge and help themselves to something. So it's patience. It's about patience and getting them to learn about three meals a day, you know, and watching, you know, that we eat healthy. But certainly when they first come in, I don't like to sort of straight away bring in the rules, because I know what they must be feeling, you know, having not had food. I have had children who've taken food and hid it in their room because, and I've said, you know, what's the reason? And they've said, they're scared I'll run out one day, and they're squirreling away for the day that we maybe run out. So it's really important to make children feel reassured that, you know, they're in a safe environment and they don't have to worry about being fed.
Yeah, thank you, Karen. So finally, Karen, we've had a practical question here. Can you foster and work part-time?
Yes, I work.
Okay.
I fostered, and my first two children that I told you about that I had for 13 years were really quite a challenge. It was a good match. They were really, really lovely, but we hit the rocky teens and we went through ups and downs. And I just felt I needed to retrain as a social worker so I could understand the social worker mindset. And so while I was fostering, I wasn't allowed to do university full-time, but I was allowed to do university part-time. So I did my degree over 4 years instead of three. And they've allowed me to work part-time as well as foster. You can do it. It's about picking the right company to work for, because a lot of companies are very understanding if you foster, and they understand that you will be called away sometimes and you will have what we call lack reviews and PEPs and things like that, which can't be done after you finish work. So yeah, it's about having a work environment that's flexible. If you have a work environment that's flexible, you can definitely work and foster. And yes. The way I look at my salary, it just means more fun for us. We have more money to spend on holidays and things like that. I love taking my children on holidays.
Yeah, and about finding that balance, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
So finally, Karen, what would you say if anyone's watching now and they're thinking about fostering like you were, you know, back in 2003, 2004, what would you say to them?
Go for it. Honestly, it's been the most life-changing thing I've ever done. I'm normally what I call a 10-year girl. I had my career choices last 10 years and then I flip and then I try something else. And so I've had 10 years at everything, but fostering has been the one thing that I've really, really enjoyed. I wish I'd started it sooner. I really do. I'm 66 now. People keep saying, are you thinking of retiring? I just can't see myself retiring. You know, age isn't a barrier to fostering, which is what I've really enjoyed as well. You know, they don't say, oh, you're too old. You know, as long as you're fit and able, you can continue looking after children and mentoring them through it. So, yeah, it's never too late. And just go for it, really. You're not going to regret the decision you made. You really, just watching children flourish in your care and turn is just one of the most amazing experiences to have.
Oh, Karen, you've been so inspirational today. Thank you so much. We've had so many lovely comments. Pam, Layla, Julia, Princess Lottie, they've all left lovely comments, and we'll make sure that you see them later on. Okay, Karen, thank you so much. Pleasure. Thank you so much for joining us, Karen. And thank you to you for watching and sending in all your questions. Wasn't Karen just so inspirational? Don't forget, there's lots of information on our website at nfa.co.uk. You can see it scrolling below me now. And the team are available on the comments and direct messages now if you'd like to get in touch. So just send a message. Or you can email events@nfa.co.uk and join us on Zoom on Tuesday evenings to find out more about fostering with us. We have that on Zoom every Tuesday. So thank you so much for watching today. Thank you once again to the wonderfully inspirational Karen, and we'll see you again soon. Thanks, bye.